I witnessed, recorded, and produced these videotapes of the Washington, D.C. hearing. Their authenticity is above question.
This is produced as part of the ongoing work on the website, thewaythetruthandthelife.net.
This is a hearing about the government licensing the electrocution of people to cause grand mal seizures. Think of the millions of dollars taxpayers' money spent to pay psychiatrists and their supporters and for the worldwide travel in putting this conference together, while the victims and opponents had to pay their own way.
Thank you. I'd like to ask the members of the audience, in a sense of fairness, if there's any individual who has not yet spoken, either as a speaker or as a questioner, and has not had a chance to come before the mic, could they step forward? The woman back there in the line, would you step forward in the front line, the next two, and then the people who are online, we can take the next, if you please.
My name is Susan Foote. I'm a professor at the University of California, and more relevant for you today, I'm the consumer representative on the FDA Neurological Device Panel, which has considered issues of safety and efficacy of ECT in the past. Indeed, our panel met in November of 1982 and made a unanimous recommendation to the Food and Drug Administration, which has yet to take action on the issue. So I'm in sympathy with you today with all the intensity of the information you're receiving, but be grateful that you'll have an opportunity to make a decision which will have some effect within a few days rather than a few years. I just wanted to let you know something about the FDA so you'll know what other federal agencies are doing. Our panel consisted of five neurosurgeons and neurologists and one who is a neurologist and a psychiatrist, as well as myself and an industry representative. Our panel unanimously recommended that the FDA mandate performance standards for ECT devices. And much of the testimony that you've heard today, we have already heard 2.5 years ago. Our recommendation was based on a sense that some action ought to be taken on this issue. We were not persuaded that safety and efficacy could be ensured through performance standards, and therefore we recommended that the agency go forward with drafting the standards, but the reclassification out of the highest standard, Class 3, would not take effect until the performance standards were mandated. The agency has yet, in the 10 years that they have had authority to mandate performance standards, they never have. So we're waiting to see whether this will be the first opportunity for such standards to be developed. My hope is that this panel will be well enough informed about what the Food and Drug Agency will be doing in the future. And we've heard from a member of the agency that a decision is forthcoming in the next few months. That you will address in your consensus statement some of the issues that we'll be considering in the future at the FDA, so that there will be some coherence to the policy that will be ultimately arrived at. Because the FDA does have enormous effect on the product itself. It has no jurisdiction, as you know, over the physicians and the treatment. But much can be done in ensuring an environment of safety and efficacy if the devices themselves are making it. And so I'm pleading with you to address that issue in your consensus statement. I have just a brief question just something to raise with Dr. Pitts on the issue of what is safety. He is not using the definition of safety that we're accustomed to use in evaluating safety and efficacy. It's a weighing of risks versus benefits. To assume the treatment is safe because people don't die is really not considering all the factors. So memory loss is a risk which must be weighed in balance. And to eliminate that risk and other risks about is really an improper use of safety, at least from the FDA definition of the term.
Thank you very much. That's good.
I don't believe that my use of the word safety was improper. It may not have included everything from the last few
I'm Dr. Martin Rose, and I work here at NIH. I have a question for Dr. Freeman. Dr. Freeman, you gave data on patient acceptance of ECT. Do you have analogous data for drugs which might conceivably substitute for ECT?
The answer is really quite simply no. As far as I know, there's been no systematic studies looking at patient acceptance of other sorts of psychiatric treatment. The same applies to many medical treatments. We're in the process of trying to start a study along those lines at present, looking at surgical procedures to see how acceptable they are. Our study is being turned down by an ethics committee on the grounds that it's going to be too upsetting to ask surgical patients about what's going to happen to them and how much informed consent they would be given.
Is there anyone in the line over there who's not spoken at all yet in the microphone? The gentleman in the blue shirt is very interested.
Dr. Alex Huang, Chairman, Teaching Director of this community hospital. I'd just like to make some remarks here about the commitment of the kids. First of all, I'm here to judge on the safety of ECT, but I am here to say something about the safety of anesthesia and the management of the patient. I'm one of those persons that Dr. Pitson said was the most dangerous person to have in the treatment room. Of course, from my point of view, the most dangerous person is the one that uses drugs they're not trained to use. And the remarks that procedure is very safe. Yes, Dr. Pitts mentioned something about having the monitors and not looking at them. Well, we do look at the monitors, and we found some things that would make our hair stand on end. For example, question of the arrhythmias. And these patients that have pre-existing cardiac disease, if you check the monitors, they do happen, and you have to have a very high concern on how to treat them. Also, the question of blood pressure dropping in this patient of being high, if you did not monitor them, then you would think the whole procedure is safe. Now, if you take the time to check the blood pressure as the treatment is being done, which we do, it's not extremely unusual to find blood pressure shooting up to the 200 to 250 range and dropping off to the 50 range. Although they be transient in certain individuals in the proper situation, you can lose the patient very quickly that way. And if you're going to lose a patient, you're probably going to lose them first with airway problems and next with heart or cardiac irregularity. So I think that from the standpoint of this, that this should be something not taken too lightly. Thank you.
Thank you. Is there anyone else who has not spoken? Yes, sir.
I would like to second what the anesthesiologist said concerning blood pressure. I have made it a routine for the past 2 years to monitor systolic blood pressure with the semi-automated apparatus. I would not suggest that this should be a mandated routine, but I would advise it. I would also like to re-emphasize what some of the principal speakers have made from the standpoint of a plea to the panel not to prematurely foreclose on the parameters of the current that are used to optimally induce a seizure at the lowest possible current. And in that regard, I would like to make just one additional point, which has been missing from the proceedings, and that has to do with the total stimulus duration. I don't know if Dr. Leland Weaver is here from Vermont. If he's here, I wish he would identify himself. But I would like to present what I interpret to be a point of view that he has consistently presented in numerous articles over the past 10 years. And that is that the current machines that are available limit the current duration to a total of 2 seconds. Now, recent data from Weaver and perhaps from some other laboratories, I haven't seen Malice's data, it's still in the press, suggest that if one extends the total current duration to the range of 4 or even to 6 seconds, it then becomes possible, particularly with bilateral current application, bilateral electric application, to have a very much lower total current input and obtain a very therapeutically satisfactory treatment. So the main point is not to have premature closure on the issue of all the current parameters, including the total stimulus duration.
Thank you. Could you give your name, please? I didn't know if you did.
Dr. Al Satin from Indiana.
Have you not spoken yet?
No, I haven't.
You have. You can speak.
My name is Virginia Robinson. I'm with the Center for the Study of Psychiatry. I've been working in the social reform area and patients' rights for over 12 years. In 1972, I was working with the ACLU in Detroit, and I continued working in this capacity since then. I simply want to let you know that I've personally met hundreds of individuals who have been damaged by this particular treatment that's being looked at today and who are very distressed about that. I have observed as a journalist and as an activist in this area that the issue is not purely medical, but is also one of politics. It is not simply Republicans and Democrats, but on a broader scale, who can, there is a position where psychiatry and psychiatrists often attempt to help people adjust to their lives, and I know it's an attempt to help, but very much too frequently, these individuals need other kinds of treatment other than these kinds of intrusive, pressuring treatment. It is a feminist issue, which is also political, that's been touched on, but I don't think strongly enough. The majority of individuals damaged by ECT are women. They are unhappy with their lives. There have been numerous studies now as to why women become unhappy with their lives. And I would hope that the panel would really look further into that as they come to a consensus. Thank you.
Thank you. One comes to a choice if one believes ECT in fact works, and also perhaps that there is some morbidity associated with it in comparison to other medical problems. Cancer, coronary bypass surgery. The patient with cancer certainly has a substantial risk of continuing with the cancer, has enormous morbidity, usually with the treatment, sometimes the risk of mortality. These are way out of line compared to anything we've heard. Rational people do make choices to perhaps lose their fertility, they lose their hair, they perhaps can die from some of these treatments. It seems perfectly reasonable that rational people might choose to lose some of their cognitive function in order not to lose their families, their job, and also their lives.
Thank you.
Consent issue, remember to consider the right to treatment. There have been numerous decisions saying that in psychiatry we have an absolute requirement to treat patients as we see medically fit in our judgment. Don't recommend something that will impair the rational patient's decision to choose to have ECT. The involuntary patient, the patient in the public hospitals of Texas, for example, are victims of this kind of political conflict and do not get ECT because of the political conflict. So I would urge you to consider the right to treatment because the people in California voted with their feet. The ones that needed ECT went to Arizona and Nevada when California outlawed ECT. And I want you to remember that the majority of patients that I've treated and the majority of patients treated with ECT are the silent majority out there doing what Freud said to do, which is love, work, and live. And they're not here demonstrating or making all kinds of statements about the torture they went through. They're out living their lives, which is what the object of the treatment is to begin with. Secondly, don't rule out bitemporal ECT. Why is it that 90% of practicing psychiatrists in this country use bitemporal electrode placement? Why is it that 70% of British psychiatrists use bitemporal electrode placement? I would submit that Dr. Weiner's study is a brilliantly executed, randomized, blind study, which is one that has to be done, and which raises, in my mind, questions as to whether or not unilateral might actually work, which I don't think it does. From my experience using dexamethasone testing, other objective criteria. The point is that it's an open question, so I urge you not to just throw out bitemporal ECT. The last thing is that it's not an all or nothing thing. We use electrode placement that is in between bitemporal and bifrontal, and I don't worry about the fact that it takes more current to get a seizure because, as Dr. Weiner, I think, pointed out, it is skull and sinuses there which don't get damaged by electricity, as the brain, I don't think, gets damaged. So all I ask is that you consider the scientific evidence and consider those patients who are well and functioning because of ECT. Because you have heard of vocal minority and you have heard the 2 minutes that each of the other patients who benefited from ECT got to present. So keep in mind the disparate amount of negative information that you get.
Yes, I suppose the memory loss, I do remember my name, which is Meyer Tracy Fader. And I'm the FAR representative for the Committee of Physical Psychiatry. And at this point, I wish the psychiatrist didn't exist because I'm very angry. I have stood here for 55 minutes and I have a back injury from ECT and I do want to be heard. I would like to suggest that there are other reasons that people become depressed than being mentally ill, and you can refer to my own personal testimony. I would like to suggest that every person who's going to receive ECT, if they must, receive a complete physical workup in a physically oriented hospital without the bias of mental disorder or mental illness on their records. And I'm glad that President Lincoln did not exist during the days of ECT. He's the most famous person to have had melancholia. As to informed consent, my husband was informed by two psychiatrists that, quote, ECT was a 100% cure, that I might suffer a slight headache and perhaps a few bruises. Was informed consent, and he signed the form because he assumed that professional persons were knowledgeable and as honest in their profession as we were in ours. The results also are in my testimony. I have read the APA's proposal consent form, and our committee has proposed its own consent form, 843-0430, with the FDA. It is in understandable terms. I happen to be an educator, and I don't understand your terms. And an educator should be included with your booklets and whatever else you're going to put out to inform lay people. Included in our consent form is this information, that the one adverse, among others, effect is that in all cases, memory loss occurs. Had my husband received this information, he would not have signed those papers. He lives with the guilt, and I live with the result.
I'll finish
as soon as I can. I represent over 70 participants of our committee. However, I am speaking of hundreds, maybe even thousands, of persons who cannot articulate for themselves because of what has happened to them. It has taken me 15 years after you got through with me to be able to stand up in front of you and say this to you. Last year, there were 5 persons who took FDA-approved medication because of memory loss, I don't know what it was. They became desperately ill and they were put into intensive care. Perhaps it was a fatality, I don't remember. However, this drug was immediately removed from the shelves, from the market, and Eli Lilly was sued. Now, according to the federal government...
I'm sorry.
Well, I do want to be heard, and I'm going to be
we would like to have a copy of your informed consent form with the material that you recommend.
I also want to ask you, do you consider the patient victims who have gone through this with this device that the FDA has not taken off the shelf any less valuable than these five persons and the potential victims?
Thank you for your advice. Dr. Gregory?
I would like very much to remind the panel that despite the deluge of claims from professionals today about the efficacy of electroshock combined with the pharma stories about depression, that as Dr. Hoffman demonstrated, there are but two studies that even deal with the question of efficacy beyond the period when the person is acutely brain damaged. That is, beyond that first month, there will be two studies in the thousands that even deal with the issue of is the patient improved. So there's no real evidence for improvement beyond the organic brain state. I also want to remind you that I challenged a number of the physicians here to produce papers to support their view that suicide is prevented by electroshock. We had that invitation from Dr. Hirschfield again today, Dr. Abrams, and Dr. Wyman. And yesterday, all Dr. Abrams could produce was one more Adrian Winokur study, which actually showed no difference between untreated patients and ECT patients in regard to suicide. I would like to offer two challenges. There's really one challenge. Can Hirschfield, Weiner, or Abrams produce a study that shows that suicide is prevented by ECT? If so, I'd very much like to be able to give it to the panel of comments. And second, Dr. Roth is here. Four specific questions I'd like you to answer very specifically. You presented your program as one that really dealt with informed consent. First, did you tell the patients that the treatment is controversial, as Dr. Roth demonstrated? Second, did you tell your patients that over half the people who get the treatment, I'll review these with you if you want, so over half the patients who get the treatment feel they have permanent memory? Third, did you mention any evidence of brain damage? And fourth, did you describe the frightening experience of the acute organic brain syndrome? So first, secondly, if either of you three doctors would like to produce some evidence that electroshock prevents suicide, give me a paper that I can actually copy down to my patient and present it to the panel. I'll give it to you. And second, Dr. Rothman, answer this question. Dr. Rothman.
I think those are good questions, Dr. Bregan. The first point about my research was that it was naturalistic research working with the available consent form and within the context of patients receiving clinical treatment. This was not an experimental study in which I embarked upon all aspects of information disclosure that you might deem relevant, some of which I do not deem relevant. I will tell you so the first thing that the patients did, of course, was to look at the consent form, and my study was related to their understanding of the consent form. The second portion of the study, in which I informed the patients, I did go into some of these matters, but they're certainly not to your satisfaction. I will say the following things. I did not tell the patients that the treatment was controversial. I happen to believe that the treatment is effective, and it is effective for the patients who the treatment was being administered, and so I did not say that it is controversial. I did say, which is perhaps another way of what you're saying, is that the treatment is not always effective. The data that we have, or that we use in our hospital, is that the treatment is 80 to 90% effective. That means that presumably there are some patients who do not recover or are helped, and the patients were told that. With respect to brain damage, I frankly would not tell such a thing to a patient, Dr. Bregan, because I do not believe that there is evidence of brain damage or brain injury on the basis of the scientific literature. I know you feel that that is the case, and obviously that is a matter of controversy.
It's not a controversy that you know about.
Well, I don't want to jump to a conclusion about my answer to that. I'm listening to this. I'm serious. I'm listening to this panel and the variety of information that was presented here, and I think that some decent points have been made about long-term efficacy and other issues which this panel, you know, in its wisdom needs to consider about what is efficacy and what is controversial. Certainly, when there's agreed areas of controversy, then I think patients should be told about controversy if there is genuine scientific disagreement about it. The patients are told about memory loss. At the time I was doing this study, which was in the late 1970s, Dr. Squire's studies, which are quite elegant studies, were not available to the extent that they are presently. The patients were told about the period of acute memory loss, that they would not remember the treatment, and that they would have memory deficits around the time of treatment. In fact, that was one of the items that we used to test the patient's understanding of the nature of the side effects as to why they would not remember the treatment. However, I did not have available at that time Dr. Squire's studies about anterograde and retrograde memory loss on the spot of trying to type it was presented here. I think that information should be presented to patients, and that is a matter of how science progresses.
Thank you. There is a woman in a brown suit who had this problem.
They, a doctor's going to produce a suicide study. They asked them, they're conferring in that.
There is obviously some differences in interpretation about the suicide study, which you have done a good job, I think, in pointing it out. I think we have to go on to the next speaker. Can the woman? Ma'am, would you like?
I submitted this letter to the panel, and I was not going to speak, but I'm listening to some things that are getting me so angry that I have to speak. I was a patient who benefited from electroconvulsive therapy, and get very angry when I hear professionals and laymen talk about the dangers and inhumaneness of the treatment. If it wasn't for this treatment, I probably would not be able to be here today to listen to the debate on whether electroconvulsive therapy treatment should be administered. Seriously ill people. I'm going to cut the letter that I wrote a little so I can finish in 2 minutes. I was sick in 1976, 77, clinically depressed. I was 54 years old. I went to all private psychiatrists with the traditional methods of individual therapy, antidepressant drugs, one after the other. My condition didn't get better, and so I was hospitalized. I voluntarily entered a private psychiatric hospital in this area. Despite my record of individual therapy, they continued with group therapy, family therapy, prescriptions of more antidepressant drugs. I was a resident of the hospital for 3 months and showed no improvement despite the best efforts of the psychiatric staff and the support of other patients at the hospital through group therapy sessions. At this time, the staff indicated to my husband that I wasn't improving, that they didn't know how to help. If only at this time the psychiatrist at the hospital would have recommended electroconvulsive therapy treatment, I would have been spared about another month of misery, living as a clinically depressed person. Instead, the psychiatrist advised that my husband should look for consultant advice. Luckily for me, my husband called NIMH and they gave him the names of doctors who could give the advice. Immediately, the consultant recommended electroconvulsive therapy. My reaction, I suppose, was a normal one. I was clinically depressed, and who was I to really be asked whether I wanted to get this kind of treatment? My husband's reaction was also negative. In fact, the psychiatrist recommended we go to another psychiatrist as a consultant for another opinion. Luckily for me, again, we went to a psychiatrist who recommended electroconvulsive therapy treatment. The doctor explained to both of us the medical procedure. Finally, we consented. What alternative was there? Should I remain suffering with depression, or should I try this other form of treatment? By this time, I had been depressed for almost a year, and my condition was getting less static or even getting worse, rather than death. Electroconvulsive therapy treatment was administered to me at another psychiatric hospital. I was given a minimum amount of treatment, seven in all, in 2 weeks. I responded positively. But I was a functioning adult, as I was concerned, a 95% functioning adult, and that wasn't good enough.
Could you finish up now?
Yes. Okay. I just want to read these. As for memory loss, which everybody seems to be harping on, and I'll end it here, I don't remember the period of severe illness. However, as my doctor explained to me, this may have been due to the fact that I was so ill that I couldn't attend to anything for any period of time, rather than to the electrical electroconvulsive therapy treatment. I've had no memory lapses since my recovery. I went back to work. I was a reading specialist before my bout with illness. I went back to work for 7 years as a reading specialist. Afterwards, I've just retired. And if it weren't for that, for the treatment, I would not be a functioning adult.
Questions or information that are asking specific information about the expertise of the panel, we are not going to respond to the public, but we should, you know, respond to the private situation.
But yeah, I would hope you understand my concern for informed consent. But the actual parameters that characterize Donald Johnson.
So I understand that
would be included in
one of the areas of neurology.
I'm glad you're on the panel, and I hope you will take the trouble to try and ensure that in layman's language, which I think foot pound is probably the best layman language term.
I think that's true to a degree, but I think also to consider that the delivery system and some of the other factors that dissipate current, you really have to...
It's off for some reason.
That less than 2% of the actual skin surface electricity actually enters into the central nervous system. So instead of talking about 200, we're talking about 4G, it's actually getting into the brain.
Yeah, and the type of information I really would be interested in is the amount of electric potential placed across the a single axon.
Yeah, they've done measurements.
And is this sufficient for axonal destruction?
No, it isn't. And secondly, I want to inform you that there are medical devices that are being implanted in brains, especially probably blind people with their stimulators.
I'm familiar with that.
And those have a much higher current density than what actually flows through the brain during ECG. These have been badly studied.
You do understand, we're talking about still a gross of, in the order of 100 to 200 joules of energy.
Like 200 joules of energy going to the total body. I think some of the cardiac arrhythmias and some of the other things that happen have to do with current flow in other areas of the body. But I've been measuring inside the brain as to how much actually goes through, and I can, just to use a very quick analogy, the current density that goes through the brain at the time of electroconvulsive therapy is about 10 to 30% that which is delivered with medical devices designed like cerebral stimulators or occipital pulse stimulators. No, so I'm saying there sure is current effect, and it's there, but I think the reason wouldn't put that kind of weight drop on the hip.
Well, they're not dropping it. How high would the energy put into you?
I'm sorry, I'll catch it, but
sure.
One shock treatment can equal 150 joules of energy. This is equal to dropping a hammer on someone's head from higher than a five-story building.
At the FDA hearings, the testimony on the reclassification of electroconvulsive devices cited the literature as whether signed or false, typically about 150 joules of energy in a treatment. With the new Climatron electroconvulsive device, if you check out at 400 volts maximum of 0.9 amps and 320 some millisecond pulses.
Could you finish up your question, your remarks?
Yeah, I would like somebody to tell me. I'm a teacher as well as a physicist, and I brought a kilogram with me. Teachers like to demonstrate. Now, this is a kilogram. It's 2.2 pounds. Heavier than a hammer, I used to hit a hammer. But I wonder if possibly like Dr. Stein could tell me how high I would have to drop this kilogram from in order to have it hit the ground with 150 joules of energy.
I don't know if that question is in the purview of the panel, but that should be important. I'd like to go on to the next person.
This is only 10 joules of energy. You're talking about dropping it from higher than a five-story building. But that's physics. Supposedly in pre-med bed drops.
Thank you.
I never got it.
All right, out with your gun.
Huh?
Out with your gun.
Okay, this won't hurt. It'll be over in just a moment.
Uh-huh. What's that?
Conducting.
A little dabble, do you? Right, Mr. Jackson?
Open your mouth.
What's that?
This will keep you from biting your tongue.
Oil?
Now just bite down on it.
Oh.
That's right. Just bite down.
Huh?
Now bite down on it.
Are you ready?